A very good morning and welcome to the 12th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have no apologies. Our first item of business for today is a decision to take agenda item 3 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Our next agenda item is an evidence session looking at the client experience of Social Security Scotland's redetermination and appeals process. The committee held its first evidence session on the 28th of March with organisations that support clients. And today we'll hear from Social Security Scotland and the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service. So I welcome to the meeting Gail Devlin, Deputy Director for Health and Social Care, Social Security Scotland. Tim Barraclough, Executive Director, Tribunals and Office of the Public Guardian, and Leslie Black, Director, Tribunals, Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service. So thank you all for accepting our invitation. Just a few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we start. If you could please wait until I or the member asking the question say your name before speaking. And can I just ask everyone to keep questions and answers as concise as possible? So I'm going to move straight on to the questions. And the first one is based on the theme, getting decisions right first time. And I will ask Gail this question in terms of the impact the local delivery service is having on ensuring clients provide full information in their initial application form. And is the agency actually monitoring whether contact with local delivery is reducing the likelihood of redeterminations as well?
Good morning, convener. Good morning, committee. Thank you for your question. Let me begin by saying that local delivery has a really valuable role, providing support to local communities, our partners and stakeholders, as well as our clients, and that's been recognised in our client surveys and positive feedback from our stakeholders and clients as a whole. The local delivery team support clients directly with the best possible way to support the application process and provide the right information at the right time. So when booking an appointment with local delivery, our client advisors will speak with the client and actually make them aware of what the best possible support and information that they can bring along to that discussion when meeting face-to-face or over the phone with a local delivery member of staff. We also support the clients during those face-to-face appointments by supporting that application question by question, capturing the responses given by the clients, in turn explaining the questions and accurately capturing their response. It's important to note local delivery client support advisors are not decision makers in the process. They're there to support rather than to guide or drive the answers to those questions. At the same time as we capture that response, we submit the application and all of the support and information that the client provides at that time. We also give them an update after, a summary of that meeting, and capture any additional supporting information that the client support advisor may think will be useful, and the next steps in trying to seek that, whether that be the client themselves or us as an organisation. Clearly we have a role in gathering that information. On the second part of your question, it's really important that we capture the right information about our service, and whilst I would repeat the point I made about local delivery not being part of the decision-making process, we don't capture the direct correlation between outcome and local delivery input at the outset of helping the client with the application. We'd hope all our clients have that support in one way or another to make the best possible application they can. And it doesn't guarantee a positive decision because local delivery have been involved, but it almost certainly gives the client excellent support at that stage.
Okay, that's helpful, Gail. And based on from the witnesses, I think that there are many more requests for redeterminations and appeals for ADP than for other benefits. Why do you think that is?
ADP actually represents 10.2% of the total decisions of new applications, so the numbers are actually very low and they're well below the forecasts for redeterminations as a whole for all of the other benefits. Adult disability redeterminations and appeals, although below forecast, they are our most complex and biggest benefit to date. For each client, we're assessing 12 activities in a way that looks at every client as an individual, and we're assessing the impact on their daily living and mobility of their condition. Low-income benefits, by contrast, have clearly defined eligibility. There might be a single payment, and it represents probably benefits that are less, or payments that are less complex by their very nature. The fact that we do have those requests for redetermination demonstrates, in my mind, the system is working well, it's accessible, it's approachable. As an organisation, we're building trust with our clients that they feel able to challenge a decision. It's of utmost importance that our clients do feel that they can challenge a decision where they feel they've got more to offer by way of information, and that, or where we've made an error. It's very important that we're able to provide that service to our clients overall.
OK, thanks, Gail. I'm now going to invite Katie Clarkin. Thank you.
Thank you very much, convener. So how many redeterminations and appeal decisions are based on new information compared to perhaps just taking a different view of essentially the same flags? Because I think what we're quite interested in is, given the complexity of, for example, you know, adult disability payment, whether it's reasonable for different decision makers to come to different conclusions on the same facts. I don't know if Gail maybe would want to come in on that, you know, first of all, specifically, you know, to what extent there's new information that changes outcomes.
Thank you. So on the first part of your question, we don't collect data specifically on the variance of what the data we've collected at the first application as opposed to the redetermination. But we do have a public duty to look again if asked by our clients. So we're listening all the way through that client journey. There's no artificial cut-offs or hard deadlines or where we're not willing to consider that new information. That's a very important point to make. We take a fresh look at that whole application on the basis of feedback from the client at redetermination. So the client will have given us a reason as to why they would want us to look again and reconsider our first decision. And they may feel that they've more to say and more to add on their daily activity and haven't provided that in sufficient detail. Whilst we make best attempts to collect that at the outset, Citizens Advice alluded in their evidence when they met with you recently that some clients do minimise the impact of their condition on their daily life because it's something they live with day to day and they're used to that. So our specially trained advisers do try and draw that out at the outset, but it may well be it's at the redetermination stage that they do offer that evidence. There's also,
I mean, just appreciate you may not have hard data. Do you have an impression of how often a different decision is taken when essentially the same facts are?
That's the second part of your question. So our focus is getting the right decision first time. Yeah. It's crucial that decision makers properly explain that decision for the client. And when they have that first determination, the client will see our determination very clearly. And that helps clients challenge determinations that they're unhappy with. Generally, there is instances at redeterminations in a lot of cases where we do and are presented with more evidence and slightly different facts. It is always possible that different decision makers will come to a different conclusion, but it's crucial that we capture the decision and that we let our clients know the basis of that decision. Ultimately, clients have, you know, a straightforward access to an independent and impartial tribunal if they remain unhappy.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Would one of the other witnesses like to come in on that question?
Yeah. It's not for us to say as SCTS, the administration, to say the basis on which decisions are taken, because that's something done by tribunals, judiciary. Just two points I might offer. Firstly, and it relates to some potentially issues that might come later. When it comes to a hearing, there are cases where a hearing may be adjourned because more information is requested. And obviously that information that was requested is new information that will need to be taken into account. If it's, I think the other thing to say is that all judicial decisions will take into account a number of factors, not only the facts established, but the law to be applied, how that law is to be interpreted, and also the weights you give to the facts that have been established, and there may be different views between the parties on the weight to be given to the factors. So that's how you might get differences between the initial decision and later decision on the basis of the same facts.
I mean, I don't know if Leslie would want to come in now, or I could maybe put a sort of further question to her.
Yeah.
I mean, because based on what you're saying, it seems to be that often there is other information provided when looking at redetermination or appeal. So how easily would it be to try and obtain that information during the initial decision making? And have you got any suggestions as how we could address that so that the information is captured at the earliest possible stage? I'll maybe bring in Leslie on that if she feels able to deal with that.
Okay, thank you. It's not quite possible for us to say how easily obtainable that information at first. So the information will come over from Social Security Scotland, and as part of the process, there isn't a pre-hearing process, so the first time the members of the tribunal panel will be considering the evidence in front of them will be at the hearing, and that might be at that stage that they may then ask to see further evidence in support of the claim.
I don't know, convener, if I don't know if Gail would like to come in just to conclude this part of questioning.
Happy to, thank you. We have spoken to committee before about lots of work we've done on the application forms with our stakeholders. We're working really closely with our stakeholders to raise awareness of good support and information, how we obtain that, how we collect that on behalf of individuals. We've changed our application form to include very clearly what you need to apply for adult disability payment. And, you know, as I alluded to before, local delivery are there to help, you know, support our clients navigate that guidance and complete their form. So there's lots of work going on there in that space.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I believe Jeremy would like to come in on a supplementary.
Yeah, thank you, Camino. And good morning to the panel. I should probably say at the start that I was a previous first-tier tribunal member, just to put on the record. But I wonder if I can just come back to Ms Devlin's couple of responses. Firstly, you said in regard to redeterminations you don't record that information. I suppose the question is, why not?
Well, as you know, we are very keen to develop our management information and our data and produce official statistics that are useful to us, and that piece of management information and data will be, over time, incredibly useful. And we are working with colleagues in Scottish Government to make sure that we develop that suite of data. So we don't do that at this time, but it is something we'd very much be keen to do so, in the interest of transparency and being able to demonstrate, you know, the value that we bring.
I mean, just a bit confusing, but we started with a whole new system from day one, and we're not recording information from day one. I mean, have you got a timescale of when that information will be recorded?
We record information right through the client journey that's important and that we publish, and we're asked, you know, to publish officially in terms of statistics. So we do gather and produce a vast, you know, number of statistical publications. I don't have a timeline for that, but there is plans to deploy that into the system to be able us to gather that information.
Oh, OK, that's helpful. The other question is, in regard to getting the information right first time, one of the changes was that Social Security Scotland would get the information rather than the client having to get the information. My understanding from a letter I received from Social Security Scotland is that when you're looking for that information, you almost send a letter out and it goes into a generic box, so whether it's a doctor's letter, and there seems to be a long delay around getting that information. Certainly, if you look at people that have been in touch with me, there seems to be a long delay. How quickly are you getting the information from either social work or from doctors? What's the average time from when you request that information to getting that information?
It wouldn't be possible to put an average time on a blanket way. There are so many sources of information. And I would say we are not burdening our client with collecting that information solely. We still do collect a vast amount of supporting information on behalf of our clients. We ask them to bring, you know, supporting information that they have easily to hand. We don't have data on how the average time would be.
So you don't know how long it takes when you request information from, say, a GP. You don't have an average time of how long that's taken.
No, I don't actually. Every GP practice, every health board, every local authority, you know, makes best endeavours to provide that information, but I can't supply an actual, you know, specific figure on how long that takes. Some are very, very quick. Some, as we've spoken about before, under pressure in the NHS and in GP practices to be able to return that information.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite John Mason in. Thanks.
Okay, thanks very much, Convener. I mean, I take the point, probably, Ms Devlin, that you're trying to make the system friendly and helpful and simple and all that. But and I think we have had evidence that some clients do find it quite complex and also quite stressful. Now, my understanding is the legislation has certain requirements in it, such as redetermination requests are to be made in such form as the Scottish ministers require. So can you give us a bit of an idea, how much flexibility have you got as to how the system works and how much are you bound by what's in legislation?
So we're the delivery body that is delivering, obviously, the policy, and the policy that was agreed way back at the bill stage and before that. So, you know, we listened to feedback many years ago in 2016 from the public consultation that said, although those things, they wanted a challenge process that was simple, that was clear and accessible in terms of the information and processes with clear published procedures and timescales. We have done all of that, and there is a simple process in place. I absolutely hear what you're saying around, you know, the stress that some clients do experience navigating that system, but we're absolutely committed to continually improving our service and making sure it is accessible at all times. You know, our current process is as clear as it possibly can be, but we are always listening and open to that feedback from, you know, clients, stakeholders and, you know, Scottish Government as a whole.
I mean, obviously it's difficult to change legislation, so we're not proposing to do that. But I mean, do you sometimes feel that, you know, you could make the system simpler if it wasn't for such and such legislation, or do you think that it works together okay?
It works from our perspective, but obviously if the client and stakeholders, you know, have issue with that, we are open to listening to that feedback. The forms, you know, are relatively easy to navigate, and we offer that local delivery support. They're clear, they're simple, and we do offer one-to-one and in-person support to actually complete the form. We do complete forms over the telephone too, so there are many ways that people can access, you know, a redetermination and an appeal.
Okay. Now, we did have a suggestion that, I mean, some people obviously do keep their application copies of their application forms and so on, but lots of people don't.
Yeah.
And we heard of an example where, you know, somebody was wanting to make a redetermination request, asked for a copy of their completed application form, and then had difficulty getting that. I mean, would that be just a one-off, do you think, or would normally people be able to get back the original application form?
I did hear that evidence, and it did give me great concern. That should be absolutely by exception, so wholly, you know, accept that that has been the experience of that client, which is not ideal. But I have been advised that a client can call and request a copy of these, and we will send them through the post. At the appeal stage, the client does get copies of all of the information that we send to the tribunal, and the tribunal then send to the client, and that includes their application, their redetermination, the first decision, and all of the supporting information. So I would hope it was by exception.
Okay, well, that's good to get that on the record. I mean, I just ask the other, I realise I've sent all my questions to Ms Devlin. Do either of the others want to come in on this area? Just the kind of balance between what's in the legislation, is it too specific, and what's, you know, there's a bit of flexibility as well.
I think we would say that it works, and the process of direct lodgement, I think, as which was brought in with this legislation, I think is helpful for the client in actually managing, and then we're sending all that information back out to them that the agency have submitted the initial evidence giving. So I think that has been a good step forward.
Okay. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm now going to invite Bob Dorison. Thanks.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, everyone. Technology is a wonderful thing. It got us through COVID-19, of course, continuing to operate. And there's an absolute role for online platforms in dealing with clients and applicants and those appealing and so forth. Can maybe both organisations tell me the extent to which they're using online platforms for various activities? But we also know that a lot of people don't feel comfortable online, so how do you support them to be more comfortable and relaxed, and what alternatives do you offer if it becomes evident that online is maybe just not appropriate? So maybe we'll start not with Gail Devlin on this occasion, so I don't know if Leslie or Tim wants to come in relation to this.
Just to can I just clarify the question, when you're talking about online, I mean there ways in which you engage with the process online, which may be exchanging information, but there's also the hearing process. Are you referring to the hearings as well?
So I suppose both. I'm particularly interested in the hearings process, but I mean there's a more kind of general activity online where it's not a video platform, it's going back and forward by email and the like, and I get that as well. So perhaps both, Mr. Barraclough. Sorry, but both, yes.
Sorry, can I just come in before that and say, I believe that area questioning in terms of hearings has been allocated to Marie. So if you could maybe focus more on the application and the forms, really. Sorry.
I think I would like to focus on the application and the forms, Mr. Barraclough.
I think there are two elements here. There are two elements. An appellant wants to or it lets us know that they have difficulty in dealing with things online, we can provide things obviously in paper form if that's more convenient for them, if they don't like using email or online engagement. And the other thing is that we obviously train our staff and judiciary to respond to any requests that we may receive in order to actually help people through the process. We have to, as a tribunal, and obviously we're completely separate from Social Security Scotland with this, as an independent tribunal, we have to treat both parties even-handedly, but we will do everything we can to help people understand the process. And I think the other thing, if I may, because I haven't had the opportunity to say this, is the tribunal, although it was established in 2018, the volumes have been so low for the first few years that we really haven't started to test the systems until about now. So we're learning an enormous amount about how it's operating or not operating. And we're very keen that sessions like this and the engagement we have with our users helps us improve. I think we have a real sense that there's a lot more we could be doing better. And this is actually a very helpful way in actually identifying what that is. So we need to know more, perhaps, from our users, now that we're getting a larger volume of them, what it is that we can do to help.
So you've got online communication with service users, and they're not getting back to you. They're part of the way through giving information. They drop off the radar a little bit. What do you do?
I don't know if there's...
We would follow up if we're waiting for stuff. I don't think we've actually experienced that thus far, because as we've heard, that actually the volumes coming through to date have been lower than anticipated, and that's actually now where we're starting to sort of test our systems and processes in earnest. But it would be about managing that information to get it to be able to be scheduled in front of a tribunal panel.
It's clearly not an issue currently, so I'm sorry for pushing on something that may not be an issue, but what does follow-up mean? You would follow up, so if such circumstances did arise, what would follow up, what would that look like?
So that would be about the caseworker. It might either be engaging if it's with the agency to understand if there's something missing, or actually speaking with the user themselves. But as I say, I don't actually think we've had too many instances of that to date, but that's something I think in that improvement space that we would look to be following through on.
So picking up the phone to the service user or contacting Social Security Scotland to find out if there's something else going on?
Yeah.
Right, OK. So it's a bit stating obvious, but I just wanted to get that on the record. Gail Devlin, any comments on this line of questioning?
Yeah, I'd reiterate the points I've made earlier. A redetermination form is available in paper, as is an appeal form, and that local delivery support is offered right across Scotland in 180 venues. So people can request a home visit face-to-face in libraries, community centres, prisons, hospitals. We're accessible that way. We also have our independent advocacy support for those with particular difficulty in working online too. So that's an independent advice and advocacy resource, as you know.
Okay, just one more question. I sometimes think that organisations sometimes can't win. I'm quoting, and she was an excellent witness and she made some really good points, but Erica Young from Citizens Advice said people get an overwhelming amount of paperwork, but at the same time also said in her written submission that communication with the Tribunal Service can be vague and sparse, so in one extent overwhelmed with information and paperwork, and another level sparse information. It must be really difficult to get the balance right for both the Tribunal Service and Social Security Scotland, not to overwhelm people, but then to make sure they're suitably informed. So how do both organisations get that balance right? Leslie, do you want to go first?
Thank you. So we are starting to engage with our users. So the President will be having user group sessions to understand and get a little bit more feedback from that. We do have feedback forms as well, which help us to understand. We've had few so far, but that will help understand. We're working on some guidance around the points at which a user might expect to hear some communication from us. So actually they'll be aware at what points they'll hear from us. We have also developed a user portal. Now, that is online. We've not widely publicised that yet, and that's something that I think we feel that we could do more to publicise. So that would be a sort of self-service where a user can go online and find out what stage their application is, their appeal is processing through. But again, I think there's some improvement work there where we can listen to what the users want, and actually we'll be able to build that into our process.
Could the user go on that portal and just say, can someone just give me a call? I'm a bit confused.
I don't think they would do that via the portal. It would be more likely that we've got some contact details online and on any communication they get, so they can actually phone the casework team for a bit of help or support.
Just on the portal, it's actually a mine of really useful information, and it will also generate notifications, again, to the user that there's been a change. So they can track their case, and if a new document has been lodged or the hearing has been scheduled, they'll get a notification that there's something for them to look at. And it's something that has been developed. But as Leslie was saying, we could do a lot more to make people aware that there is that facility, because there is a question, your question about what's the right balance. I think there's a balance to be had with actually sending people information and overloading them with information, or letting them know the information's there for them to find out if they want to. And then again, finding out what that balance is something we need to get feedback from our users on.
Again, I'm not trying to create an issue that's not there, but the portal sounds like an excellent idea, but there could be, by definition, lots of information in the portal, and it's navigating your way through that portal. Yeah. So is there assistance available? Once you publicise that a bit more, how would you support clients navigating their way through the portal?
I think we need to get feedback. Having seen the portal, it's designed to the latest sort of standards of user accessibility and ease of navigation. It is actually extremely simplistic in its presentation, so hopefully it is relatively easy to navigate. And again, I think this is something that's part of the further development process where we can get some information. Because we haven't had many people using it, we need to get people to start to use it to find out where the difficulties are.
Okay, thank you. Gail Devlin?
Yeah, I think it's a really important point, striking that balance for their clients, and I do take on that point about too much information overloads particular clients. But as per the legislation, in relation to appeals, we send the information to the tribunal that is required for the tribunal to perform its role, and they send that to the client. And that includes, as I referenced before, their application, their original determination notice and all that supporting information. And it's important that we give the client that, because if not, it limits their ability to fully participate in the proceedings at tribunal. So the overriding objective for us and the tribunal, I'm sure, is fairness, and that we give the right level of information for the client that is fair and just and enables them to attend a hearing in the best possible way.
I think that's very helpful. Just one final thought. Maybe it can be rhetorical, and you can be right back to the committee or update it at a future date. But the portal sounds great, but busy staff, when people are phoning up asking for advice and details and information, the easy reply might be in the future to say, it's all on the portal, just go to the portal. And you could lose a bit of human contact there. So is that something you're maybe, again, I'm not trying to create a problem that's not there, but it's self-evident that would be a very quick and pithy thing for a busy person in an office on the telephone to say and reply, it's all on the portal. And of course, that should be the first point of call, but not as a kind of default way of not having that human contact.
I think that's a fair point, but I think we would promote the portal and showcase its benefits, but always be receptive to what the user wants in terms of how they want to access that information. And if it is by means of actually speaking to somebody on a call, then that's how we'll do that.
Thank you very much. Thank
you. Okay, thank you very much. Moving on to theme three, which is quicker processes. I'm now going to invite Ros McCollan. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Thank you very much for coming along this morning. We've heard a reasonable amount of evidence, really concerned and raising concerns about timings, especially when it comes to redetermination of ADP or ADP appeals. Now, I notice, and I'm going to highlight this, and well done, is that the Social Security Scotland has been working to bring down processing times for initial decisions, which is fantastic. But what impact has that had on times taken to complete redeterminations? And if I could have a detailed information, Ms Devlin, if you wouldn't mind giving me that information. Thank you.
Thank you. So I'd point out that 76% of our adult disability redeterminations by 31st of January 2024 were completed within the 56 days. I recognise that performance is... It's essential that we maintain that, but there are robust capacity planning and resource measures within that team to ensure that we manage that performance and that we meet the statutory deadlines. I would point out that the impact of processing times and the work that's been done to reduce those has not affected the time taken to complete redeterminations. They are separate teams, first decision teams and our client experience teams that handle redeterminations, with very robust capacity and resource planning in each. But demand is, you know, as I stated earlier, below forecast, but we are absolutely, you know, mindful of that performance and ensuring that we meet the deadlines.
Yeah, thank you for that. I think there's an issue sometimes that when everything is performing well, the things that aren't quite performing as well, even though they're still within deadlines, do stand out like a sore thumb. And I think that might be the situation. So the very separate process, but everything is being done to make sure that those standards are being met, and we're comfortable that that will be the case?
Absolutely. We are tracking performance daily within those teams.
Okay, thank you. Moving on, what additional resources are the Tribunal Service and Social Security Scotland, putting in place to manage the expected numbers of ADP appeals? And if I could start that with Ms Black and then Mr Barraclough, and then Ms Devlin, if you wouldn't mind making your comment for Social Security. Thank you.
Thank you, yes. We have had an increase in the number of staff to resource the Social Security Chamber. That was primarily through a transfer from Her Majesty's Courts and Tribunal Service, so that we the benefits have been devolved to Scotland. So we had a transfer of some 24 people came over from the reserve system and are now working within SCTS to deliver. Similarly, we look at our capacity planning and modelling based on the modelling figures we get through from Scottish Government around those anticipated volumes. So we have resourced to be able to match that demand.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Balakoff,
and
any comment?
In addition to that, as well as the staff we brought across, obviously an increased volume will mean an increased requirement for hearings. So there is a process to increase the number of members of the tribunal. That's a judicial appointments process run by Judicial Appointments Board for Scotland, and that's done through from a request from the Scottish Government. So we're not directly involved in that, but we've made it clear that we need more members to actually sit on the hearings, and there is a recruitment process. I think there's one ongoing now and one for later on this year, so we should get many more members.
Can I just ask a sort of timing question, which you might not be able to answer, but what's the hope when you'll have the additional members in situ?
I think there are some additional members. Are they being assigned at present?
Yes. So we've got some members are about to take up post sort of May-June time. So I think that's in the order of around just over 100, I think it is.
And then there'll be a further process later on this year. So, yeah.
So adequate scaling up.
Yeah.
Thank you. Ms. Devlin, your comment.
Thank you. We have actively recruited additional resource within the team within Social Security, and we currently have sufficient numbers of presenting officers to cover the hearings per day. We're right in the middle of a recruitment exercise, and we expect to recruit new presenting officers with those joining us by the end of July.
I was going to ask the timing question. You've just answered it. Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks. I'm just going to quickly bring in Jeremy. Thank you.
Grateful. If Mr. Mason would be probably asking this question in regard to cost around this. Obviously, there's very few hearings taking place in venues at the moment. Previously, when it was the Tribunal Service running the UK, they had a number of Tribunal Services that they rented rooms in certain locations, perhaps fixed. Are you using the same venues? And how much are we having to pay for these venues if they're not being used very often?
Short answer is no, we're not. We have three. The SCTS has three tribunals centres, one in Glasgow, one in Edinburgh, one in Hamilton. Social Security is primarily based at the one in Glasgow. And in addition to that, we have access to a number of venues which we would hire on a hearing-by-hearing basis.
So as tribunals increase with the numbers, how far would you be expecting people to travel for those tribunals?
We would hope to be using venues across Scotland so that we have access to, it is the HMCTS, venues in a number of cities across Scotland. In addition to that, if there were particular issues with difficulties in travel, we have also the facility to hire a venue locally. So it would be on a case-by-case basis.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Paul Keenan. Thanks.
Hey, thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. And I suppose building on this theme of delay and the length of time it takes in terms of an appeal, obviously we had a discussion there about resourcing and about the support for the processes. I wonder if there are other barriers that would be experienced that cause delays, and I suppose what action has been taken to deal with some of those. I think we've touched obviously on previous answers on some of those, but I wondered if Ms. Devlin maybe wanted to come in first to talk about the other barriers that exist in the appeals process.
The appeals process, we have a very small part in the appeals process. The tribunal undertakes the appeal. So our part in the appeal is lodging that appeal and providing all the relevant information to the tribunal service within a statutory deadline.
In terms of the collation, though, of that information, I mean, are there challenges within that? Because I know in other parts of the application process, for example, there have been some issues in terms of information and collation and timescales around that, or do you feel that there's not an issue there?
There is a very tight prescribed legislative deadline, and in the majority of cases we have absolutely met those deadlines.
Sure. Okay, so I wonder if Ms Black wants to comment in terms of what other barriers may exist within the appeals process.
So currently our average time from receipt of the appeal to a hearing is around 20 weeks. And I think we would like to see that being shortened a little, but 10 weeks of that is actually some of those statutory deadlines that's baked into the process. So we can actually only schedule a hearing after that sort of first 2 months. Principal issue in there is about scheduling hearings, and that might be about the availability of the parties and the availability of members of the panel, so those judicial members that will make those decisions, and whether we've got slots and the timescales and actually where the hearing has been requested to take place. So these are all the different factors which come into play when scheduling a hearing. We may be able to increase hearing loadings, and that's the number of cases a panel can hear by day if there is a change to members' terms and conditions, but that's a matter for Scottish Government.
So in terms of, I suppose, going back to that resourcing piece and how personnel essentially is supported, so your view would be that there could be a shift there, as you say, in terms of the workload and the terms and conditions that are associated to that?
Yes, so currently a panel will hear 2 cases per day, and if there's that change to their terms and conditions, we are believe that could go up to 4 cases per day. So obviously when hearing volumes start to increase, that would then mean we'd be able to bring those hearing times down.
Okay. But just to emphasise what Leslie was saying, I mean, probably the biggest issue is simply getting all the parties together in the same place at the same time, or if it's online, at the same, it's proving quite challenging sometimes to, particularly where some appellants are represented by agencies. The agency representatives have incredibly busy schedules, and it's hard to find times where everybody can get together at the same time. But the increase in number of hearing slots might help with that.
So you think perhaps more flexibility in the system would allow certainly those agencies to consider how they... Because I imagine they'll be supporting a volume of cases very often
indeed,
as well.
Yes, indeed.
Okay, and I wonder, I suppose, tied to this is, I suppose, the stress that an appellant feels in terms of the process, and going through the process can be a stressful time, particularly around waiting, the collection of information. I mean, what do you think we could do more to make it a less stressful experience?
So I think the work we're doing in there is about giving them a choice on the method of hearing, so whether it is online or in person. We're actually finding from our feedback that our users actually do enjoy the online hearing, that actually that can be less stressful than attending in person. There's obviously the option of supporters and advocacy workers to support the user during that process, and we do ask them what needs they might have, which we would hope to be able to take into account. So these are all the types of measures that we hope that might reduce that stress.
And the use of technology, I think, is of interest about how we perhaps use that to make the system less stressful and indeed quicker. And in another committee, I had a visit to the Courts and Tribunal Service to have a discussion about the use of technology across the Courts and Tribunal Service. I mean, is it something certainly you would see as being, we could do more in that front, you know, with a bit of investment in testing change, essentially, with some technology that might, you know, it's certainly, for example, the recording of notes using AI, you know, the use of more, as you say, virtual hearings, you would think that could be helpful?
Absolutely, and this is the work that is we're already starting to think about more broadly across Scottish courts and tribunals.
Okay, thank you, convener.
Okay, thanks very much. Before I go on to the final theme, which is face-to-face appeal hearings, I just wanted to touch upon something you'd mentioned, Leslie, about, was it over 20 staff you'd brought in from reserved? Have you felt that the feedback that they're giving you and lessons learned from the process that they've dealt with in the past? Has there been any feedback on that at all?
So the process is different from the reserve system with the direct lodgement, but the feedback we're getting from staff is that they enjoy the use of technology. So we have built our systems, which are quite digitally dependent in terms of the case management system and the data transfer from the agency, so which make things run smoother. So their feedback is They are enjoying working within the Scottish system, they enjoy working with SCTS, and they enjoy the systems and the processes that they're using. So they're really pleased to be working with us, and some of their colleagues, I think, wish they had been able to join too.
Thanks very much. Now I'm going to invite Marie McNair in. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. As the Convener said, I'm going to cover appeals hearings, so I'll probably direct my questions to the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Services. From the figures you've provided, in-person hearings are either kind of non-existent or minuscule. I've noted the figures at 0%, 22%, 23% and 1%, 23%, 24%. Why is that the case?
So the hearing model, so when the Social Security Chamber began, it was during COVID, so the default was obviously we had to do our hearings largely on telephone. And I think I said earlier, actually our users are saying that they actually enjoy that method, that modality of hearing type. We have had very small numbers, so that is possibly part of it as well. And we do anticipate that we will see requests for in-person hearings to grow over time.
Just that your figure suggested that more people had been seen, you know, in person, sort of among COVID than now. So I suppose your figures kind of don't suggest that, but I'll take that. Cheers. The committee has heard concerns that more difficult for the tribunal to assess more appellants needs over the telephone compared to seeing them in person, given the nature of what we're dealing with. What are your views on that, Mr. Barraclough?
There's one sort of clarification which would be helpful on this, is when you're talking about the tribunal assessing a client's needs, are we talking about assessing their needs and their ability to participate in the hearing, or assessing their needs in terms of the decision whether or not the benefit should be awarded? Because there's two different sets of issues there.
Participating in the meeting, yep.
It's one for the tribunal to assess whether they're getting all the information they need, and that if the appellant is being given sufficient opportunity to provide the information in the form that is that they need to. Appellants are asked in advance. They are asked in advance what their needs are and whether there needs to be anything that will help them participate in the meeting. And we will do everything we can in order to try and meet those needs. If it's kitting out the hearing centres, providing support services, we do provide interpretation services as well. And there have been instances, I think, where the tribunal cannot force an appellant to come to an in-person hearing. They can advise that they think it would be a good idea to do so, and there have been cases where they have done so. But as Leslie was saying, it appears to be the case that appellants themselves tend to prefer not to come to in-person hearings, that they actually quite like the telephone approaches. As I say, it's not something we can, or the tribunal can, enforce on someone. It's a difficult balance to strike. As the hearing is occurring, the tribunal will obviously, if they become aware of that there are difficulties in getting all the information they need, or that the person is not being able to participate properly, they may actually take steps. They might adjourn the hearing and say, that can we do this a different way or not? So there's the opportunity to take that into account.
Thanks. You said that in light of the feedback, you accommodate the appellant's preference wherever possible. What do you mean by that?
Well, at the moment, if the appellant will be asked what mode of hearing they want, whether it's a teleconference, video conference, or in person, and depending on what their choice is, we will go with their choice unless there's really compelling reasons not to. Cheers. So we'll accommodate that choice essentially.
Okay. You sent on the revised template letter that will allow appellants to kind of request their choice of hearings. If the appellant doesn't use it, what requests a type of hearing by sending in their appeal via email or telephone, would that be accepted?
Sorry, could you say that again? I didn't quite catch that.
If the appellant doesn't use it, but requests a type of hearing by sending in the request via their own letter, email or telephone call, will that be accepted?
Yes. You don't. We're not compelling them to use the form, but it's just making them aware of the different options available to them, but of course.
Yeah. That's good to hear, thanks. And if a representative is mandated to act on behalf of the appellant and sends a request in on one of their template letters, it was obviously mentioned within their evidence session, or emails or phones, will that be accepted as a notification of a type of hearing wanted?
Yes.
Okay, that's good to hear, is it? And one final question. Does the Tribunal Service expect that, obviously, you know, it will lead to an increase in face-to-face hearings? And obviously, can you just expand on kind of what preparations are made to accommodate? You covered that a wee bit earlier on, but if you would just expand a bit more.
One interesting thing, just to mention that our President is very keen on, is that he doesn't like using the term face-to-face because he thinks that sounds confrontational. He much prefers to say in-person, which is kind of more the feeling or the vibe that we want to have in our hearings. As we were saying earlier, yes, we have a suite of our own venues and access to venues that are currently run by HMCTS. At the moment, we do not use those HMCTS venues very much. We're talking about once or twice a month, I think, for a number of them. But the capacity is there for us to increase that usage quite substantially. So we are already equipped, I think, to take on a larger number of cases.
It's really important that organisations work, you know, to get the best experience for the client. So thank you.
Yeah.
Cheers.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to bring in Jeremy, and then I believe Bob would like to ask a question as well.
Thank you, Gina. Just a couple of questions. One's a bit nerdy and nichey, and I apologise about that. But in regard to, obviously, we've got the new tribunal service set up. Previously, we had precedent set with cases that went. Does the new tribunal follow those cases, or are we starting with a blank piece of paper from the first-tier tribunal decision-making?
That is a legal question for judiciary rather than for Scottish courts and tribunals as the administration, so it's not something I'd be able to provide a definitive answer on. That's something, as I say, the judiciary would be able to comment on. Sorry.
Okay, no, that's absolutely fair. The second question I have is in the submission by Voiceability, it states it's possible to participate by video conference or by telephone, by paper, or rarely in person. I'm concerned with that wording, that the presumption is that, as you would call them, in-person sittings are rare, and that almost kind of pushes the client down thinking this is going to prove more difficult. Are you concerned with that wording, and do you think it should be more explicit that it's whatever the client wants? This is what the legislation says.
Well, this is why the letter has been changed, to make that more explicit, that they have the choice and that we will accommodate that choice.
But has Voiceability been told that?
Only if they're... this has only just come out, actually, this week, so if they haven't, we can follow that up with them.
I think that would be helpful, because yeah. I think if I was reading that as a client, I would be thinking, oh, it's really difficult to get... in-person one. And I think if Voiceability or any other third sector are given that advice, we want to make it whatever the client wants to have their best
interest. That's certainly our intention. And I think, going back to what I was saying earlier, it's clear from both these evidence sessions and the user feedback we're now getting, there's much more we can be doing to make it evident what the choices are, and that there needs to be some more guidance and more engagement so that people understand that. And that's the kind of journey we're on, and we're not getting it completely right at the moment, and we can improve. So this is actually a helpful way of flagging up those issues.
Thank you. I welcome that response. Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. I'm now going to invite Bob in. Thanks.
Thanks, Convener. Just a very brief question. It was really positive that you confirmed that the appellant can request telephone conference, video conference, or in person. Do you anticipate any longer waits for an appellant that requests an in-person sitting to be the case? Because by definition, I think getting folk around the telephone, around the computer, will be speedier than getting them all in the same venue. So I appreciate there may be a slightly longer wait, but I'd like to make sure, obviously, that it's not a prolonged wait, because that then might marshal or funnel people into selecting a choice that isn't really their choice. They just want the matter disposed of more speedy. Can you give me any reassurances around that?
I think the point you raise is correct. It, just as a matter of reality, it's more difficult to get people all together in the same place as opposed to joining from different places on a remote platform. I think what we were saying about increasing the availability of hearing slots, if we can, and making sure that we make full use of the capacity we have in venues, should minimise that. That difficulty as best we can. We will be very conscious of it, and we will have to monitor. It will depend also on how many in-person hearings are requested in the future, and those numbers may increase, but we will have to wait and see whether that increase will be within the scope of our capacity to deal with it, or whether we need to do something else. It's a slight step into the unknown in that respect.
I appreciate that, and I appreciate it will just take longer, but it's making sure the appellant can make an informed choice.
Yes.
And that you monitor the differential and how long it takes to get that in-person sitting. And I don't want targets for targets' sakes, but there should be some kind of a reasonable wait rather than a prolonged wait if it's resourced appropriately. But at the moment, it's just too early, I suppose, to work out what that differential will be, I suppose.
Given the numbers we've been dealing with, it's impossible to say. And it will be very interesting that this coming year, when the numbers are really ramping up quite significantly, we'll start to see what the patterns are and what the strains on the system will be.
So, thank you. That's reasonable. Thank you.
OK, thank you very much. And that brings our questions to an end. So thank you all for attending our meeting today. And the committee will reflect on the evidence heard and consider its next steps. So this concludes our public business for today. And we will now move into private to consider the remaining items on the agenda. Thank you.